Good morning, everyone. Let's start with the new topic, walking aids. Coming to walking aids, these are the assistive device which helps any individual to walk independently. So as the definition tells, aids that assist people who have difficulty in walking or who cannot walk independently without one. These external aids are crutches, sticks, frames, wheelchairs, and the rest. Braces and splints which can be used to assist walking are not described in this book. I have referred Dina Gardner to make these notes. Basically, we have three types of crutches, that is axillary, elbow, forearm crutch or gutta crutch. Walkers and wheelchairs, that is frames and wheelchairs, are also used as assistive devices. Now, what are the general use of assistive devices? First one, to reduce weight bearing. This reduction in weight bearing is necessary for those who have undergone operation of lower extremity or any soft tissue injury where weight bearing is not advised. So that time crutches can be given to reduce the weight bear. Second one, gives additional support where balance is impaired or strength is inadequate so that the person becomes independent in his daily activities. Coming to types, types of crutches. First one, axillary crutch. This is how general axillary crutch looks. The parts of the axillary crutch are axillary pad, hand grip, and rubber ferrule. So, ideally, this was made up of wood a long time ago, but now it is made up of metal. The main difference between wood and metal is the wood gets damaged early, metal doesn't, though it has corrosive effect. Second thing, metal can be adjustable where wood cannot be adjustable. So axillary pad is usually placed 5 cm below the axilla just to avoid impingement of the brachial plexus which is present in the axilla. Hand grip has adjustable clips or screws to adjust the height. And the down part is rubber ferrule which provides friction control so that the slippage during walking is avoided. It catches hold of the ground. Position of handpiece and the total length of the crutch are adjustable in axillary crutch. Coming to weight transmission through the axillary crutch. Axillary pads should rest against chest wall properly, approximately 5 cm below the apex. I just now told the reason is that in order to avoid the impingement of the brachial plexus which is present in the axilla. Second one, hand grip should be adjusted to allow the elbow to be slightly flexed. Weight is transmitted down the arm to the handpiece. Weight is borne on no account, weight is borne through the axillary pad. Coming to length measurement. When we are talking about length measurement, there are two types of length measurement. One is shoe on, one is shoe off. Shoe on, the person is wearing the shoe and then you are measuring the length for axillary crutch. Whereas shoe off, the person is not wearing the shoe. These two types of measurement are taken depending on the person's need. If the person has to go to the office or go out of the house for a longer duration, shoe on measurement is taken. Whereas he's been restricted in doing daily activity or he's not going out anywhere from his home, then shoe off measurement is used. Let's look first one, that is shoe on. The measurement is taken 5 cm vertically down from the axilla. That is the point where your axillary pad is resting, from that point to 20 cm lateral to the heel of the shoe. This is the most accurate method. Coming to shoe off. Shoe off method, directly the measurement is taken from apex of the axilla to the lower margin of medial malleolus. Whereas in shoe on, 5 cm is reduced from the apex of axilla and till the floor 20 cm from the heel is taken. Whereas in shoe off method, the apex of the axilla, the measurement is started from the apex of the axilla to the lower margin of the medial malleolus, where the distance between the margin of the malleolus and the floor is avoided. Coming to the third point, measurement from axillary pad to the hand grip should be taken because we already know that hand grip is also adjustable. Hence, that measurement is also taken. This measurement is taken while the elbow is slightly flexed, approximately 15 degree from a point 5 cm below the apex of the axilla to the ulnar styloid. So this is the length measurement for the axillary crutch. Coming to the second one, The last point in the length measurement is usually taken in the standing position for axillary crutch. Coming to the next crutch, that is your elbow crutch. I'll just shift this aside. Okay, yeah, this is how your elbow crutch looks. The part of the elbow crutch are elbow cuff, hand grip, and rubber ferrule. So usually elbow cuff is made up of metal. It has metal or plastic forearm band. That is, elbow cuff or forearm band is usually made up of metal or plastic. Press clips or metal buttons and the rubber ferrule. Press clips and the metal buttons are just to adjust the height. Total length is adjustable of the elbow crutch. The elbow crutch renders 60% of stability to the patient using it. Weight transmission is as similar to the axillary crutch. Coming to again, weight transmission, as I told, weight transmission is as similar to axillary crutch. Weight is transmitted to the handpiece when the elbow is extended. Coming to measurement, when we are talking about elbow crutch, usually the measurement is taken in shoe on position. So elbow crutch, shoe on method, the measurement is taken from the ulno styloid process, that is your ulnar styloid process, with elbow and slight flexion again to the 20 centimeter lateral to the heel of the shoe. Please remember, when you are doing shoe on method, it is always 20 centimeter lateral to the heel of the shoe. In the end point, starting point, let it be wherever. For example, in axillary crutch, it was 5 centimeter below the apex of the axilla. In elbow crutch, it is 20. It is ulno styloid process of the elbow, where the elbow is in slightly flexion for approximately 20 to 30 degree. Coming to the last type of crutch, that is your gutta crutch. So gutta crutch looks exactly like this, which has forearm gutter, that is this part wherein your forearm is placed through the gutter, the hand piece, that is this part, and then comes the rubber ferrule. So it is generally made up of metal. This is a recent one. First the axillary crutch was developed, after which the elbow crutch was developed, and after elbow crutch, gutta crutch was developed. So it is usually made up of metal, padded forearm support, and the strap, adjustable handpiece, and a rubber ferrule are the parts of the gutta crutch. Total length is adjustable in the same way as elbow crutch, in the length of forearm support and in the angle of handpiece to allow for the deformity. That is the angle of handpiece. This is the handpiece and this is the stable support. So this angle is adjustable in case of deformity. Coming to length measurement, it is taken in two positions, that is in standing and in lying with the shoes on. Standing position, olecranon process till the floor, and lying with the shoe on position, flexed elbow to 20 centimeter lateral to the heel. Coming to pre-crutch training. Now we learned what are the types of crutches. So when we are physiotherapist, we need to know what are the types of crutches. We need to know which type of crutch should be provided to which type of patient. So once you understand elbow crutch, or for example, you take axillary crutch, you want to give it to some patient who has undergone tibial implantation. So you know that axillary crutch is going to be helpful because you have to do weight transmission techniques using non-weight bearing, partial weight bearing, then coming to full weight bearing. So before doing that, there are a few things to remember before doing that. That is your pre-crutch training. So pre-crutch training involves, before a patient is made to walk with the crutch, the training undergone is known as pre-crutch training. So before making the patient walk with the crutch, the therapist has to assess the patient whether the patient is capable of using it or not. If he has severe balance issue, then you have to treat the balance first and then let he do a crutch walking. So let's see what are the important things which are needed to perform crutch walk. First comes crutch muscle strength, balance, gait pattern, psychological state of the patient. So there are few muscles known as crutch muscles. So those are very important when you are training crutch training. If you have one of the crutch muscle is your elbow extensors, that is your triceps brachii and biceps brachii as well. because you have to maintain the elbow in slight flexion when you're holding the crutch, whereas you have to do the extension when you're weight bearing using the crutch. So this action, slight flexion and extension, again slight flexion and extension, is common when you're using the crutch. So you have to train both biceps brachii as well as triceps brachii. Any one muscle is weak. Think about your biceps brachii is weak. You cannot maintain the elbow continuously in extension, even when you are lifting the crutch. That will become a weird way of walking because you have to bend the elbow and then lift the crutch and then place it at a new point. Imagine a person is already having biceps brachii weakness bilaterally and you tend him to give a bilateral axillary crutch. Then he will not bend the elbow and lift the axillary crutch, whereas he will rotate the axillary crutch to the side way. He will start using that pattern. So crutch muscle strength pre-assessment is very important before training the crutch, before training crutch walking. Coming to balance, if a patient has severe balance issue, then giving the crutch is of no use. Treat the balance first and then give the crutch. Though the crutch is going to increase his stability, but still the crutch has only small weight bearing aspect. As you all saw in the previous slide, I'll just show you the rubber ferrule. The diameter of the rubber ferrule, which is touching to the ground, is very small. So this is compared to your foot size, this is very small, though it can increase the base of support by increasing the width of base of support. Still, it is very small. So hence, having good balance is very important before training a person with crutch walk pattern. Coming to gait pattern. Imagine a patient has circumductory gait and one more patient has antalgic gait. So crutch walk is better when you are suddenly given the crutches to those patient at a single time, to the antalgic gait patient, because there is only pain. He is avoiding the weight. Whereas in circumductory gait, the cause of the circumduction is stroke. It is not due to something which has happened in the lower extremity for which you are training him for the crutch walk. No. Reduce the spasticity so that the triggering mechanism, the spasticity triggering pattern, is reduced to avoid the circumduction. If there is any need of the crutch walk, then you prescribe him crutch and train him for the same. Coming to psychological state of the patient. Psychological state of the patient is very important because it is important to understand the use of the crutch. For some duration, the patient shouldn't weight bear on the extremity. But if crutch is not given, he will promise the clinician or the therapist telling that I will not weight bear the foot on the foot, still at home he will touch his great toe while walking here and there, which will induce at least 20% of weight bearing, so which should be avoided. Hence he should understand the psychological state of the patient, make sure he understands temporary dependency on the crutch by his mental acceptance and need of ambulation and independency. These three are important under psychological state of the patient. Coming to prerequisites. First one, assistance should be near if needed for standing or walking by the patient, for if he has balance issue. Simultaneously, start treating for the balance related problems from physiotherapy as well as medical point of view. So once you have started treating, once you have achieved the goal of walking in the balance therapy, start with crutch walking. But that time you cannot tell a patient to just, once you're treating the balance, to just hold the crutch and walk and I will sit and see how you're going to walk. No, you have to be present to just provide assistance if needed. If the person feels giddy, if the person loses his balance, provide assistance. A therapist is a must before or while he is walking with the crutch. Second one, before the patient uses crutch, instruct him how to use the crutch, how to adjust the height, how to use the crutch, how to walk. You have to demonstrate, even you have to demonstrate the walking pattern chosen for that particular patient. So these are the prerequisites.